with our brethren on live stream.
Yes.
Wonderful fellowship.
Yes.
Tonight, we're continuing the Gospel of John. This will be our 70th exposition of this book. We're going to begin the 6th chapter tonight. This is a rather lengthy chapter, as you know, so we'll probably be in here for quite a while. We're going to be covering the first 4 verses tonight. As you may know, that even though there were a lot of prophecies about Jesus before he came, they were so unique and so different that they were veiled to many people, most people, as a matter of fact. They couldn't grasp. They were just of another order, speaking about things that he had to almost talk in parables and parallelisms to even express them. Mm-hmm. And even at their best state, after Jesus had been with them for 3 years, about the best the disciples could think of was, "Art thou at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" Which he is going to do, but that was, See, that shows that they were a little bit hazy. Some prophecies spoke of remarkable things. It took place in the flesh and in the spirit too. For instance, Isaiah said, "The eyes of them that see not, that see shall be not be dim. The ears of them that hear shall hearken. The heart also of the rash shall understand knowledge, and the tongue of the stammerers shall be ready to speak plainly." See that? It was real, but it was figurative too. See, it was this how God had to talk about what was coming with Christ, because the people just didn't have a grasp of this nature of things. Malachi said the Son of Righteousness would arise with healing in his wings. See, you understand some of what that means, but this was pretty difficult for the people then. The things he said were not even in the scope of human understanding. They were like a sudden change in somebody. This is unheard of, unless fear came on them or something like that. They'd seen some overt miracles of a rather large proportions, like the parting of the Red Sea, miraculous supply of special food every day, drinking water out of a rock, like come out like a river, sun standing still for a whole day so they could fight. See, those were miracles of a large... Matter of fact, there's never been anything on that scale since Moses.
That's right, yeah.
It was that large of a thing. Food supplies were very small, lasting over an extended number of years. But when Jesus came, Satan's empire was assaulted.
That's right.
And the effects of his presence were immediately neutralized. People didn't gather bread that they didn't see actually fall, but they saw it actually multiplied before their very eyes. Thousands of them eating. See, it was a different order. The disciples saw storms rise and fall at the word of the Lord. And yet, it was mysterious to them. What manner of man is this? See, it was mysterious to them. A lot of succeeding generations had never seen a miracle of any kind previously. Any kind of miracle was very rare before Jesus. Any kind of miracle was. It's very rare. Sometimes it goes centuries, sometimes a millennia, without ever a miracle being wrought. Seen. Now Jesus came and he was like he's a shaft of light shoved into time. And it was so arresting that people began following him every place he went. He did something other miracle workers never did. Mm-hmm. He majored on teaching instead of the miracle.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And he taught with words wherever he went, he did this. Uh-huh. And his teaching was marvelous also. People weren't accustomed to this, to hearing a man speak like this with such authority. Mm-hmm. You weren't accustomed to this. Now our text is going to deal with how Jesus responded to this kind of thing. See, men in the flesh, they'd exploit this. They'd exploit this. They'd big offerings, or you know, they become famous, or they'd. But Jesus, he didn't do this. He was a God-man. Now our text is the first four verses of John 6. After these things, there's a whole lot. I like the way he covers the past, these things, you know, just. After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias, and a great multitude followed him. Because they saw his miracles, which he did on them that were diseased. And when Jesus went up into a mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. And the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was nigh, or close at hand. I do want you to pick up on the way John writes, too. He writes like a man that knows what he's talking about. It isn't like he was real ignorant and God fed him stuff and he said it. He wrote like a man that knew what he was talking about.
Remember they give him before you get off that introduction. This the miracles in a natural order, they were for a different purpose. Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil.
Yeah.
And he very precisely dismantled the kingdom of Satan.
That's right.
And in the end, he destroyed himself. He destroyed the devil,
yeah.
The one that had. But these other miracles, see, Satan could work around them. He could actually take the miracle, like the standing of the sun, and all these, and make men worship the sun.
Yes.
And do all kinds of strange things because. His kingdom wasn't affected by those miracles. But these other miracles,
that's right.
As you've already stated, were of a different order.
Yeah.
And they were targeting a different work.
That's right. They were undoing what Satan was doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, previous to this, as you may recall, after hearing about the death of John, he was beheaded. When Jesus heard about it, he went by a ship to a desert place apart. He withdrew from the multitudes. The people heard it, you remember, and followed him. He sailed across the lake, and they walked around and got over the other side before they did. And there's where he fed the multitude with the 5 loaves and 2 fishes. See, Jesus attracted the multitudes. But that's not why he came.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. And as he was set apart from other religious leaders, that is why they would come. See, so he could, at the peak of importance, he could just withdraw and leave and go someplace with his disciples. Now, in our day, there's a lot of stress placed on God doing our will. This is a tremendous amount of stress that's placed on us. Fulfilling your dreams and helping you meet your goals. And the slogan for today might very well be, "My will be done." You know, that'd be a...
Yeah, that's right.
Really, that's kind of how people approach Christ. Our will be done. However, even though Jesus would be more qualified than anyone else to say that, if it was right for someone to say, "My will be done," Jesus would be more qualified to say that than anybody else. Mm-hmm. But instead, he said, "God's will be done," and at the peak of popularity, he goes across the sea to another place.
Amen.
He went over the Sea of Galilee. So he's not an opportunist.
Uh-huh.
That's not what he was, or a promoter or a career builder. He was not here to solidify life in this world.
Amen.
That's not why he was here. As there are still people that think that's what he's about. There are still people that think that. What Jesus really wants is us to have a Christian nation. Well, this isn't so.
That's right.
The Jewish nation was a God-appointed nation. He didn't come to solidify them. So why would he solidify some other government? Prior to this, he crossed the sea and there was a storm at sea, and he quieted the storm. And Mark tells us that the disciples just before that had returned and told him everything they did and everything they said when they went on that special mission from him. That time he told them, "Come ye yourselves apart into a desert place, rest for a while." There were many coming and going. They had so much as no leisure to eat. They departed to a private place privately. Now, you'll pick up on this as we go through this. And then that's the occasion where he fed the multitudes. There's a proper mindset for kingdom laborers. Mm-hmm. I must work the works of him that sent me while it's day. For the night cometh and no man can work. Leisure service has to be cut out of the kingdom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Ho-hum. Mm-hmm. It's got to be cut out. Mm-hmm. Can't be in there. There's no place for this at all.
Yeah.
We'll have plenty of time tomorrow. No. Mm-hmm. Now, you can't make this happen. I'm just telling you that this is not the kind of people God works with. People that procrastinate and put off and delay and hesitate and inconsistent and erratic. They shouldn't be surprised if they're not employed in the kingdom of God. This is not the kind of people God uses.
Yeah. The word heartily.
Heartily.
Along a mindset.
Heartily, that's right. Yeah. Now this kingdom mindset, this is why Paul said, "I labored more abundantly than they all." See, he saw this with greater clarity than anybody else saw it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
This is why he said to in writing to Archippus, he said, "Archippus, take heed to the ministry that thou hast received of the Lord, that thou fulfill it. Get it done." See? It's why he said to Timothy, he said, "Take heed to the ministry which thou hast received of the Lord, that thou fulfill it." See, this is it's the mindset that drove Jesus. It's the mindset that drove Jesus. It's the mindset that drives his people. That's why Peter said to laborers, "If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever." Amen. See, that's why they talked the way they did.
That's right.
This kind of spirit is subdued just by the nature of the Christianity of our day. The nature of Christianity in our time isn't even calculated to do this. Religion is an adjunct in modern Christianity. I mean, wherever it's found, here in foreign countries. It's on the side when you have time, once in a while. That's the way it is.
Yeah.
But that's not the way it is in Christ.
No.
What God has given you to do, there's just not like a day or two of the week that you're able to do this.
Actually, our lives are lived unto God. So that's
right.
Our work is to believe. So so in our lives, our whole life is lived to please the Lord, and everything we do is unto the Lord.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And people have to take hold of this. I think there'd be people who wouldn't argue with that, you know. But that's not the way they live. Notwithstanding, that's not the way they live. But this is the manner of the life of the kingdom.
People put an adjunction to the end of the statement and say, "Yeah, but that doesn't mean God doesn't want us to have fun."
Yeah.
You see, they actually neutralize
The
seriousness of doing things precisely and heartily for God.
Yes. We have no one's word on that but theirs, incidentally. In other words, no believer can afford to be distracted by the things of the world, whatever they are. Whatever they are.
Yeah.
We're to be motivated by the Spirit of God and by the captain of our salvation. The Holy Spirit is the animator. Your faith is the means. And the work is very large. If there's some place you are where you can't do the Lord's work, you are in the wrong place.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. That make a difference? You're a fisherman or a doctor. You can do the Lord's work.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way it is. So we're charged with growing up into Christ in all things so that we can participate in edifying the body of Christ. That's what we're called to do. There's measures of this.
Mm-hmm.
Some people have a larger measure than others, but everybody has a measure.
Mm-hmm.
That's all they can handle. God doesn't give midget measures to giant people.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't give giant measures to midget people.
Mm-hmm.
Your measure matches your person.
Mm-hmm.
So improvement in all of these, I say this because Jesus, he's living this out that I'm saying. Jesus lived that out. The Holy Spirit is the administrator. 1 Corinthians 12 says he's the administrator of the gifts.
Mm-hmm.
He assigns them and empowers the person to do it. God works all in all, so God's the master worker in it. And the Lord Jesus Christ, he's the one that monitors and commands the whole operation. All this is said in 1 Corinthians 12. Then the grace of God is a great enabler.
Amen.
So as you can see, salvation, in salvation, there's a thorough equipping of every member.
Yeah.
There's no parts of the body that are unnecessary.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
They're all necessary.
Amen.
And at any given time, whatever your ability is, it will become the most needed thing at any given time. It may just be like giving a cup of cold water, but there's come a time when that's the most important thing that's got to be done.
Yeah, yeah.
See?
Amen.
You live alert.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
In view of this. Now the body of Christ as a whole, Jesus, his whole person is manifested in the body of Christ as a whole. He'll be seen in you, but you're just a very, 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 very small part of his person is seen in you, no matter how advanced you are.
That's right,
Now, no matter how advanced you are, just a very, very small part of Christ is seen in you, at your best and most mature state.
Mm-hmm.
But the body of Christ, that's another matter. And the body of Christ can minister even if people aren't with the people personally.
Uh-huh.
I know some members of the body, I rarely get to see them face to face, but they minister to me.
Yes.
Sometimes there's means of communication they have, but other times it's a recollection of what,
uh-huh,
of some of their strong points that minister to me. All right, he went over across the Sea of Galilee and a great multitude followed him. How unique Jesus was. See, the Jews, they didn't follow everybody. Yet, like if they did, they either were illuminated or deceived, one or the other. But they weren't gullible kind of people by nature. They followed Jesus. And the kind of following was virtually unknown until John the Baptist. This kind of following was relatively unknown. John the Baptist prepared the way for the Lord, and so that's why he had such a tremendous following, see, because his ministry was to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Now, when Jesus came, there followed him a great multitude of people from Galilee, from Decapolis, from Jerusalem, from Judea, from beyond Jordan. How's that? No PR.
Yeah.
No promoter. No newspapers.
Mm-hmm. No internet.
No internet. Man, different places say great multitudes followed him. They followed. He didn't follow them. They followed him.
That's right.
And great multitudes were gathered together unto him, Matthew 13:2 says. Great multitudes came to him, Matthew 15:30 says. Great multitudes came together to hear and to be healed of him of their infirmities. See? Now this was not until John the Baptist, this just was not known.
Yeah.
Now after Jesus returned to heaven, when the chief priests and rulers of the people were persecuting the apostles, Gamaliel, you know, told them that this wasn't the best thing to do. If the thing was of God, you couldn't stop it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If it wasn't of God, it'd fizzle out. And he cites a couple of men who had been leaders. He'd keep some disciples, but they were nothing like Jesus.
Yeah.
He mentions Thutis and Judas of Galilee. Thutis influenced about 400 men. 400 men? Jesus, on one sitting, fed 5,000 men beside women and children, probably 20,000 men.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah.
20,000 people. See, 400 men. I'm showing you here that a lot of Jews didn't run around following people.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And here were people that were unusually influential.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
The Gamaliel cites, it was just a relatively small number of people followed him. And Judas of Galilee drew away much people. We don't know how many.
Mm-hmm.
But both men failed miserable in their failing.
Uh-huh.
Didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way it was with the Jews until Jesus. See,
mm-hmm.
Once in a while, maybe someone would pop up and they'd go after him and it'd fizzle out. Until Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the people coming to Jesus was the working of the Father.
That's right.
He was drawing the people to Jesus. That's why they were impressed with
mm-hmm.
with Jesus. Yes, Judah?
This following here is an example or a preview of a different kind of following that would come later. They were following because of the miracles that they saw, but the magnitude of the following was something like a preview of what we see now in our following, is that no one else has the kind of following that Christ does.
Yeah.
And the devotion we have isn't just because of what we've seen, it's because of what we've experienced of his work in us.
Yes, that's
so it's
right.
A different motive for following, but the picture is the same.
Yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And before this war history is over, there's going to be another following like this. Multitudes. It's not going to be one of a city and two of a country. It's not going to be like that anymore. That's the way it is now.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh.
That's not the way it's going to be before this is wrapped up.
Amen.
This is proving to you that this can be done.
Yes.
See? This is proving to you this can be done. And God's going to do it on a large scale. But what he's going to do, he's going to dismantle the form of Christianity that exists now. He's going to dismantle that first.
Amen.
And once it's dismantled, this will happen again.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Time hasn't come yet. The church is a bottleneck. The modern church is a bottleneck. Now, I hate to say that, but it is. It's a bottleneck, just like the ancient Jews were a bottleneck.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It's a bottleneck. Mm-hmm. It shows you that you can't teach people out of this condition.
That's right.
There was teaching. There was more teaching under Moses than there was later,
mm-hmm.
as far as volume is concerned.
Mm-hmm.
But it didn't accomplish very much. But when once God enters into this and he takes away what's the bottleneck, what is the bottleneck? He takes it away. Then the thing's going to break forth.
Mm-hmm.
And he shows you that multitudes, it's possible for one man to garner multitudes of people. It is possible. John the Baptist, Peter, remember they brought him in the city from all surrounding cities. Paul, they never had trouble attracting people.
Hmm?
Some of the prophets did. Jesus, John the Baptist didn't have trouble attracting people. Jesus didn't have trouble attracting people. Peter didn't have trouble attracting people. Paul didn't have trouble attracting people. See, during those days, there was little disinterest among the people. Some of it was curiosity, I know. Even the religious opportunists and charlatans like scribes, Pharisees, Sadducees, lawyers, chief priests, even they were provoked to pay attention to Jesus. Even they'd turn up wherever Jesus, but they couldn't stay away. That's the way. After Jesus returned to heaven, the people still continued to flood into Jerusalem. From out of all the cities round about, Acts 5 tells us. And when Paul was in Asia, he taught in the school of Tyrannus for 2 years, and the whole country of Asia heard the word of God. People with a message from God will not have trouble getting an audience. I want to sort of establish this. We've experienced this in the major. It's God's done it in such a way as you can't, a lot of people don't even believe that it happened. But let me tell you, the people that have come to us to be taught. Let me just tell you, so that come to us. We didn't know any of these people. They've come to us from the nation of Burkina Faso, West Africa, Pakistan, India, Nigeria, Kenya, Ghana, the Philippines, and Myanmar. That's just all I could think of off the top of my head. They all, every single one of them, came to us. And we can mention people in different states come to us. Why? Because we're excellent promoters? I'm no promoter, and I don't think we have any real promoters among us. Why do they come? It's because of the message we've been given. That's why they came.
Amen.
When we were in Indiana, one of the heads of North Korea came, South Korea, came to visit us. I forget what position he was in. Prime Minister or something of that sort, of South Korea came here, spent time in my home, and visited and printed the Word of Truth there for several years. Completely unsolicited, completely. What is that? If you have a legitimate message from God, you will not want for somebody to tell it to. God will make it happen.
Amen.
It's demonstrated here in these accounts. Now, they came to Jesus because they saw the miracles that he did on them. It wasn't that they heard. The miracles of Jesus were never doubted. Nobody doubted what he did. Nobody said, oh, that really didn't happen. Nobody said that. Even his enemies said, oh, we can see that you can't deny what he's been doing. There's no record of any relapses of people that were healed. There's no record of anyone that lost their healing, as they say in some circles. Today, people who accentuate healing have more talk than they do demonstration. Even they will acknowledge that a very small percentage of people that come to their meetings are healed. Even they will tell you this. You'll never hear them say, and everyone was healed. They'll make a difference how famous the healer is. I'll never say something like, see what I'm saying. I'm showing here that when God's in a work, what can happen? I remember it's an interview. I heard this personally. It was an interview that Brother Jimmy Swaggart was conducting, and he was, someone asked him, said, have you ever in your ministry seen a miracle happen like before your eyes? You actually saw, they say they grew a new arm, or, and he said, no, I've never actually seen one. That's not what these...
Yeah, that's right.
That's not what these people... They actually saw something happen.
Amen.
Amen. That, this condition is rather strange since we have such marvelous media today. You could actually broadcast around the world. You could actually see the thing happen.
Uh-huh.
See? Well, with these people didn't bug. They didn't come because they heard Jesus did miracles. So they saw somebody upon whom a miracle had been wrought.
That's right. Yes.
So you read things like this. He healed all that were sick. Matthew 8:16. He healed them all. Matthew 12:15. He laid his hands on every one of them and healed them. Luke 4:40. There went virtue out of him and healed them all. Luke 6:17. See, I'm accounting for why the people followed him. Marvelous display of the power of God. Now listen. The power that's under salvation is just as precise and just as effective as the power of those miracles.
Yes.
The engrafted word, James said, is able to save the soul. And what's involved in saving the soul is even more complex than healing the body.
Amen.
Even more complex than that. These are things, there are things that accompany salvation.
Amen.
As Hebrews 6:9, we are confident of you that you will have the things that accompany.
Mm-hmm.
See, there are things that accompany salvation.
Mm-hmm.
Just as surely as there are things that accompany a leper being cleansed, or things that accompany a lame man being made to walk. See, there are things that accompany salvation. And they're strangely absent in our day.
Yeah.
For instance, there is deliverance from this present evil world that is not being lived out.
Mm-hmm.
It's just talk. Mm-hmm. See? People say we've been delivered from this present evil world, and all the while they're a slave to it.
Yeah.
The only people that should say that are the people who have been really delivered from this present evil world. They're not under bondage to it anymore. Things that accompany salvation. You can be effectively taught by the grace of God to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts and live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. See? Now that would put a lot of people out of business. I understand that. But they need to be put out of business. Charlatans need to be put out of business. People that are taking credit for things that only Jesus can do ought to be put out of business.
Right.
And there is coming a day when they will, you know.
Yep.
And what I'm establishing here is, just as those miracles upon the disease were real,
mm-hmm.
what God does in people that are saved is real.
Amen.
But it's being underplayed in this day, see? It's being underplayed.
Yes.
The church has made it too easy for sinners.
Uh-huh.
When I say the church, I mean the nominal church, by name only. It's made it easy for sinners. It's provided easy ways to cover the thing up. Or
Amen.
Ways to live and not take credit for sinning. It was my background. It was my DNA. It's so forth. Yes.
And just as those miracles that Jesus performed could be seen and verified,
that's right.
The new birth can be seen and verified
right.
as well. Something real happens, everyone will know it.
That's right. That's how you know it's real.
Yes, amen.
See, there's a tremendous amount of theory in modern Christianity. It's just theory, theoretical. So that when people say we're delivered, the average hearer doesn't have any idea what that means. Because the Christians largely are just like the other people.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. So you talk about a new man created in righteousness of true holiness. See, the average person doesn't have the faintest idea what that means. Because
right.
he's never seen someone that is obviously living for a different reason.
Right.
And with a different objective.
Right.
He hasn't come across people he has to ask for a reason for the hope that's within him, see?
Yeah.
But see, this This is a false representation.
Amen.
Just as surely as it said if Jesus healed everyone and half of them were walking out limping and uh-huh. with signs of leprosy on them, nobody would have come back.
That's right.
See? And so this, what happens in Christ is real. There are really a people who can resist the devil.
That's right, yes.
They don't have to have a help group.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
They don't have to be made accountable to anybody mm-hmm. on earth. They can actually resist the devil mm-hmm. just as surely as a healed lame man can pick up his bed and walk. Just that real. Just like a man that couldn't see could see plainly. Just that real, a man can do this. He can actually, there's a cleansing from all filthiness of flesh and spirit that the person can accomplish. Cleansing ourselves, of all filthiness of flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of the Lord. See, there, that can be done. Because of salvation. When your soul is healed, David one time prayed to the Lord, heal my soul. That can, and when your soul is healed, these things, they are done.
Yeah, amen.
When they aren't done, the healing hasn't been done.
That's right.
Well, there's been some kind of a relapse, which is kind of contradictory itself. There are some that, there are people that have a purged conscience. Their conscience doesn't plague them. Who have had a bad past? That's what happens when your soul is healed. Your conscience is purged from dead works Amen. To serve the living God.
Amen.
There are people who do live by faith and who know they're washed, sanctified, and justified. See, these are very real effects of the healing of the soul. These are things that accompany salvation.
Yes.
So when you see these, read about these healings, they have prefigured salvation, what it would be effective. Salvation would be effective. It just wouldn't be saying something what we ought to be and we hope we will be someday and we want to be. It's not that kind of thing. There's actually a transformation that takes place, a very real transformation that takes place. And the only people that know it are the people who it's happened to.
Yes.
But the conduct radically changes. Other people will inquire, what happened to you?
Yes.
You're not the same as when I saw you last. See? That's telling you, that's like someone that knew a man who's lying in a bed of sickness all his life and suddenly he's walking around carrying his bed. They say, hey, what happened to you?
Uh-huh. Amen.
And they'll tell you, you'll be glad to pass it on, what they told. See, and there are people that hear the voice of Christ and follow him. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. See, that's that very real, just as real. Well, it's even more real than the miracle healings. So Jesus went up to this mountain, leaving the multitudes behind. And so far as the valley is concerned, Jesus never gathered his disciples in a valley. You know, you just have to be familiar with Scripture to know this. He never taught them in a valley or in a plain. One time he taught them in a plain, but it was on the side of a mountain. He came down to a level area, but it was still in the mountain. His quality time was with his disciples in high places. It's pretty consistent. Now Abraham, you remember him, he pitched his tent in a mountain. Genesis 12:5. And following his escape from Sodom, Lot dwelt in a mountain. Genesis 19:30. See, I'm showing you this has been a consistent pattern. Abraham was told to offer Isaac on a mountain. Jacob pitched his tent in the mountain, offered sacrifice in the mountain. Horeb was called the mountain of God. God told Moses his people would serve him upon this mountain. The law was given from Mount Sinai. And Mount Sinai is mentioned 19 times in Scripture. It was a mountain. Mount Sinai, it's called. His discourse concerning the last times was delivered on a mountain. The Olivet Discourse, some call it, Matthew 24. It was delivered on a mountain. Sermon on the Mount was delivered on a mountain. When the disciples met the risen Christ, he told them to meet him in a mountain. Amazing. And in Christ Jesus, believers are said to come to Mount Zion. So we're meeting at a mountain now. When John was given to see the glorified church, he saw it from a great and high mountain. See? So this is God's. When you want to get something from God, you got to be in the high places. You got to be in the high places.
Amen.
And he physically did this when he was on earth. But this is done spiritually now in the high places. Yes, Brother Eric.
Kind of ties into your last point. That's what Jesus was talking about when he said, greater works than these shall you do.
Yeah.
To the disciples, that the spiritually miracles are of a greater nature, a superior nature than
greater works,
multiplying the bread,
mm-hmm.
or healing the blind eyes. But every one of the physical miracles had each one of them was like a direct parable.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
and
amen.
Even the word miracle has the meaning of a sign or a token.
That's right.
To signify.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So to have a token of something means that the token really isn't the point.
That's right.
Is a testimony of something greater.
That's mm-hmm. right.
So it's not right to seek after the token only, because that is, in a very real way, that is negligent of the greater of what the token is telling you about.
Amen.
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 And there are some real things, aren't there?
Yes.
That are be possessed. Well, after going to this elevated place, he sat down there with his disciples, away from the lowlands.
Yeah.
Above the normalities of life. Up at this high vantage point, you saw things a little more in perspective, that were down in the lower area. This is how Christ meets with his people now. He stated succinctly in Ephesians where what God has done to us is stated. He hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So that, in effect, we didn't have to climb up this mountain.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
He set us up here. And up here, the things down here look smaller.
Yes.
Up here, the enemies down here, they don't have access to you. See? Up here, you're closer to the author and the finisher. So it actually makes perfect sense. Sat with his disciples. And even now, he's making known his manifold, multifaceted wisdom through the church to principalities and powers in heavenly places. So there's people up there on the top of the mountain that are observing us down here. So those who major on things that are taking place on the earth, they're dwelling in the lowlands, see? And you can, in a moment of time, your whole emphasis can switch to what's going on earth. Particularly at this time, with the voting and all that sort of thing. Particularly at this time, it's possible for you all of a sudden, your whole attention shifts to things going on the earth. And it becomes an emphasis. It's not, you're not just, it's to look at it the right way, that's one thing. But to be caught up in it, that's something else. Someone will say, well, we can't neglect this. Well, let's see, I say we can't let it dominate us.
That's right.
Those are spiritual understanding, and Paul prayed that the church would have spiritual understanding. That's understanding of things that are in the Spirit. Those who understand the things of the Spirit, the things of the earth are too small to grab hold of their attention. They can just kind of touch on them, what's necessary, and not just totally ignore them, but they don't have a hold on them. You won't have a hold on them. Instead, we've set our affection on things above, not on things on the earth. Not on things on the earth. Mm-hmm. You can have profitable involvement in things of the earth, but you do it from the perspective of this higher place. Amen. You operate being motivated by where you're at here.
Amen.
So you see, there's good reasons for exhortations like this. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Why did he say, if ye then be risen with Christ? Because that's the only way you can actually effectively seek these things. You just, if you're not risen with Christ, you just grope. You just grope and feel after them. Again, he said, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. Let the things that make you rejoice or that make you weep, or that, let it be those things, not the things of earth. And the wisdom that is valid and profitable is the wisdom that's from above. Right? He went up to a high place. See, he talked to them from this high place. He talked to them. One time in Song of Solomon, there was a woman, her lover come to see her, and she said she was busy, she's in bed already, she didn't have time to get up. So her lover put his hand through a hole in the door. There was a hole in the door, like a rope went there, and he reached and unlatched it. He reached in there, and his hand was there, and she saw his hand, and pretty soon it awakened, and she got up and primped herself up, and dressed herself up and put on her colognes and all this, and she went out. He's gone. He left. So she went out seeking him, and she said, these are the words, move her words. She said, O thou whom my soul loveth, where thy soul feedest, where does thy soul feed? Where dost thou make thy flock to rest at noon? Why should I be as one that turneth and says, where are you at? Where are you at? She's asking. There's an answer given to her. If thou know not, O thou fairest among women, go thy way forth by the footsteps of the flock and feed thy kids beside the shepherd's tents. Go where the people of God are.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. If you really want help from God and you're having trouble obtaining it yourself, go where the people of God are. Go where there's people that have contact with God.
That's right. Amen.
And where you can't find people like that, don't make that your headquarters.
That's right. Yes.
That would be simple enough not to comment any more on it. And Jesus said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am.
Amen.
That's where I am. So it doesn't make any difference how many they are. If they came together because of me, I'm there. So the men told the lady, well, go where the flock, go where the flock's being fed. Sit by the shepherd's tents. That's the one that fed the flock. Camp out by the shepherd someplace. And it won't be long you'll come in contact with the master. Well, it's a wonderful picture, isn't it?
Yes. Amen.
And our text says the Passover was nigh. This Passover will be the second of three Passovers John mentions in his gospel. The third one is the one during which Jesus was crucified. So this is a second one in the middle. And his death is drawing nigh. He's going now from this point on, he's going to like concentrate on preparing for his death. And he's going to try and alert his disciples as much as possible to this. His discourses will draw attention to realities that be quite profound. And the last night he spent with his disciples, you remember how he talked with them about these things. See, the magnitude of one's obedience is seen in the length of time it took for them to prepare for it. If it took a person 50 years to wake up and follow the Lord, his obedience will not be as strong as the person who learned that lesson early.
Amen.
I'm telling you the truth. So we expect this. We expect new converts to be on fire.
Yes, amen.
We expect to be anxious to be where the food's fed, where the shepherd is. We expect that.
Yeah.
Because that's what genuine conversion does. And just as surely as people went, wherever Jesus went, they'd see him going someplace and well, they'd follow after him. Because
yeah.
They knew he had something nobody else had.
Yeah.
See? Mm-hmm. So let us commit ourselves to possessing something that no one else has.
Yeah.
And if you have something no one else has, you won't have to worry about being able to share it or having an opportunity to share it. And if you don't have anything like that, then you shouldn't be sharing with anybody anyway.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. See? So I'm very thankful for this. This takes a struggle of trying to get people and get people to hear. And all. It takes this, mm-hmm. reduces the amount of time you have to spend on things like this.
Uh-huh.
Be a bright, shining light that can't be hidden.
Yeah.
And there'll be inquiries.
Amen.
You'll receive inquiries. And if you have a word you'd like to add tonight?
I was impressed by this thing. He says, after these things, Jesus, he didn't say after these things, Jesus went on vacation for a couple weeks.
That's right.
This was from the moment he got baptized. He's full time.
That's right.
Going. He doesn't slow down. Of course, you know, once you get into him, he can bring you into this mode.
Oh, yes.
It isn't something that is automatic.
Yeah.
But it is a great, great satisfaction in whatever you're given to do as you do it for Christ.
Yeah.
There's a great amount of sense. There wasn't anything else that he wanted to do. This
yeah.
was his work. He was entering into it. It's wonderful to see that.
Yes, brother.
I was thinking about that same scripture you mentioned in Hebrews 6, things that accompany salvation. Now, Jesus came to town. The whole town would come out to be healed.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's why they went out there to be healed.
Yeah.
But see, they never called him here. The healer is here. He was always known as the teacher.
Yeah.
Because he called
right.
people, but the things that accompanied Jesus
it was accompanied yeah.
was the miracles like
that's
Brother
right.
Aaron was
uh-huh.
was referring to. But see, they didn't dominate the signs and miracles didn't dominate though.
Mm-hmm.
They just witnessed to his message.
That's right.
He wouldn't let the signs and miracles dominate.
That's right.
That's right.
He didn't
yeah.
promote them. He didn't. Disciples didn't go out and gather, everybody come, be healed. Everybody come, be healed. It wasn't that kind of thing.
And whoever wants to stay, we'll have some teaching now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
Coming up to a mountain to teach disciples, teaching those who are close to him. And that's kind of like what our assembly's time is like.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a high place where Jesus
yeah.
meets with those who are closest to him.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's exactly right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's
Amen.
Exactly right. You
Amen.
Can be set there. Initially, we all were set there.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
You were set there.
Uh-huh. Yeah, this kind of proves, you know, this. You said that you mentioned these two men that they had followed after
yeah.
for a short time. But if they were the kind of people that focused on that, they would have been following those men when Jesus came. I mean, this thing, see,
right.
but it cut off because eventually they saw this isn't of God.
That's right.
Now, that's a unique people there.
A greater.
Yeah.
A greater. That's God's manner. God lets the former pass away only
mm-hmm.
when something greater has come
yes,
along.
Amen.
Well, I appreciate your comments about the mountains.
It's kind of a pattern, isn't it?
Yeah, kind of a pattern. made me think of when John's receiving the revelation, he had a voice that said, come
right.
up here.
Come
yeah,
up here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Come on higher even.
Yeah, yeah. And he already was, yeah.
Amen.
Those are significant points.
Mm-hmm. Same with Moses.
Amen.
When he wanted more, he had to go, he
yeah.
was we partway up the mountain, he had to go all the way up the mountain.
Yeah.
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 Isaiah was told that, get you up to a high mountain.
Uh-huh.
Pardon?
Isaiah was told that, get you up
That's
to a high mountain.
Right.
Uh-huh.
Amen. Yeah, there's a lot of references to this.
Uh-huh.
High places.
Yeah. Amen.
Our fortress is in the high mountain.
Yeah, that's right.
In Christ are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge.
That's uh-huh. right. That's right.
Amen.
All right.
Mm-hmm.